Kara mentioned our MLK team, but I also wanted to mention the leadership team of the Centerville-Washington Diversity Council. All of these programs are made possible through the volunteers that are involved with the council. And if you're on the leadership team or the MLK committee, would you please stand up and be recognized for all your hard work? That way people can see who you are and thank you. So I wanted people to be able to see who you are because we have a few things on the table that I draw to your attention. One is it looks like this. If you are interested in becoming involved in the Diversity Council, there is a card here that you can fill out, and you can hand it to any one of the committee members or leave it at the registration table on your way out. We also have, if you really want to lock in as a sponsor for next year's MLK breakfast, we have another card there. We'll make it easy for you so you don't get left out next year. So we really appreciate everybody coming out today. I know you don't want to hear me anymore. We've got an exciting program for you today. And now that I'm done with the business part of the presentation, I would like to bring our Mistress of Ceremonies up to the podium, Marcia Bonhart, to get things started. Marcia.
Thank you. Good morning. 4 degrees, did you know that? Never mind, it's okay, there's so much warmth in here, it really does not matter. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's great to see such a crowd, and it just amazes me that so early on the morning of that, the Monday of the Martin Luther King celebration, that this place is filled, and that lets me know that there's so many people who are extremely supportive of what is happening here in the Centerville, Washington Township area. I'd like to mention that Iron Gate Realtors is also a sponsor, and that name is not in the program, but we just wanted to make sure that we said thank you to Iron Gate as a sponsor. Mayor Brooks Compton is here to bring you official greetings. He is the mayor of the city of Centerville.
I have to bring the microphone down a little bit. Thank you, Marcia. I'd first like to thank the organizers of this event. The Centerville Washington Diversity Council. All of us have, over the years, as a member of council and the city staff, employees of Centerville, we appreciate your respect to the commitment that you make to this event. So thank you very much. On behalf of the city of Centerville, its council, and Centerville city staff and employees, welcome to Yankee Trace in Centerville. We're glad that you ventured the cold weather today. As Carol said, winter has finally arrived, but we respect that you were here today. And specifically to Dr. Martin, we are our honored guest today. It's an honor to be at the podium that you will command in just a few minutes. But just a couple thoughts. Words have meaning, and Dr. King knew that his words were important to our nation and important to our nation's future. From the Birmingham jail in 1963, Dr. King wrote about life's purpose when he said, "The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. The true neighbor will risk his position, his prestige, and even his life for the welfare of others." And from his book, Strength of Love, Dr. King addressed living for more than just oneself and more for a purpose when he said, "There are some things so dear, some things so precious, and some things so eternally true that they are worth dying for." And he went on to say, "And I submit to you that if a man has not discovered something that he will die for, he isn't fit to live." And finally, to responsibility, Dr. King wrote, "If a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets such as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause to say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. We all know the words from the Declaration of Independence that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These are all powerful words that are seared in our collective memory as the very principle by which our nation was founded. This phrase in our Declaration of Independence was left by our founders not just as a statement for that time, but as a directive to all of us who have followed that work needed to be done to make sure that the meaning of those words were fulfilled by the nation that followed. We all admit, as we examine the history of our great nation from her founding up through today, that even though the Declaration of Independence said it was self-evident and did so without reservation that all men are created equal, that for far too many of our nation's citizens, even today, these are just words that have yet been unfulfilled. Today we celebrate Martin Luther King Day, not just as the third Monday in January, or a day off from school, or a day off from work, but as a day full of deep meaning for our nation to recognize not only the man, Dr. King, but the everlasting importance of his message in both words and deeds, that justice is not complete until all of our nation's children and adults read these words from the Declaration of Independence and know that it applies to them just as much as it applies to their friends, their neighbors, and members of their community that they do not even know. That is why today has become such a special day for our nation, for all of us as individuals, as those friends, those neighbors, and to those community members we don't know, what can be done, what still must be done, and what still must be done to achieve those words of the Declaration of Independence and the mission of Dr. King. Dr. King famously said that he had a dream, and he did not just tell our country it was only his dream. He challenged us as individuals of the nation to step into that dream with him and help his dream come true, so that not only would his four little children one day live in a nation where they would not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character, but that all of our nation's little children would be so judged. Dr. King started the journey to justice, and in fact, our nation has come a long way, but the journey to justice is not complete. For as Dr. King said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Welcome to Centerville. Welcome to Martin Luther King Day. I appreciate you all being here.
Thank you, Mr. Compton. And of course, because this is a collaboration between Centerville and Washington Township, we are going to now hear from the president of the trustees, Washington Township, Joyce Young.
Good morning. It's a privilege to welcome everyone to the 2016 Martin Luther King Breakfast. I'm thrilled to be here with the elected officials of Washington Township, Dale Berry, Scott Paulson, and Tom Zobrist, to honor Dr. King, a great leader whose life and words continue to inspire us. Another great leader, Abraham Lincoln, once said, "The best way to predict the future is to create it." In 1955, the year of the Montgomery, Alabama bus boycott, it was difficult to imagine a future where all people of all races could attend the same school, share the same restaurant, or even drink from the same water fountain. It was difficult to imagine a future nation where higher education, voting privileges, and job opportunities were equally available to everyone. Fortunately for all of us, Dr. King dreamed of a different future. Through his leadership and call to action, he worked to implement his dream and create a future where a more just United States first became probable and then possible. Since then, The civil rights movement has had a seismic impact on race relations and on our country. However, we all know there's lots of work to be done to realize Dr. King's dream. We have a new future to create. So, as we celebrate the goals that have been achieved, we must remember and use Martin Luther King's message of peace and justice. We must use it to inspire our actions today and to dedicate ourselves to create a future of justice and peace. In Dr. King's words, the hope of a secure and livable world lies with disciplined nonconformists who are dedicated to justice, peace, and brotherhood. Let us resolve to work together to create that future, a secure and livable world. Thank the committee for putting this together. Thank the Diversity Council, and thank you all for joining us as we refresh ourselves on Dr. King's legacy and his message.
Thank you. Thank you, Joyce. I always appreciate the committee asking me to serve as MC for this event every year. The speakers are always dynamic. And this year certainly is not an exception when we, as I prepare to introduce our speaker this morning, I've heard Dr. Herbert Martin many, many times, and it is always a delight. And I just appreciate his passion for poetry, particularly that of Paul Laurence Dunbar. And to see him recite the poetry, you don't feel as if you are hearing or watching someone recite it. You feel as if he is actually pulling you into what he's talking about. Because when you see his passion for it, you become equally as passionate. But just to tell you a little bit about him, Herb Martin, PhD, is a professor of English and poet in residence at the University of Dayton. He teaches American and African American literature and has authored 6 books of poetry. He has been associated with the work of Paul Laurence Dunbar for nearly 25 years. The books that he has written, and they are beyond the doors there for your selection this morning, Inscribing My Name, Selected Poems, On the Flyleaf, poems published by Bottom Dog Press, and The Log of the Vigilante, and that has won the Mellon Poetry First Prize, and Jump Back Honey, the poetry and performance of Herbert Woodward Martin. Also, he asked that you refer to the DVD documentary www.jumpbackhoney.com. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Herbert Martin.
She promised too much. I after seeing so many young faces, I decided that I would veer away from my, I've typed these pages at least 5 times, so here goes the 6th. I was thinking of my granddaughter. And sometimes I have to think about the way in which my grandchildren talk, and I have to really adjust my brain to understand what it is they're asking me or saying. The great grandson said to me the other day, "Do you have an ouch?" And I finally said yes. We went to the doctor, and he had to do some work on my toe, and that's why I'm sort of limping. So that curious business of "Do you have an ouch?" is an interesting way to use language that will probably show up in a poem that I have stolen. from this kid. But years ago, the oldest of the granddaughters said to me, "Did you ever drink segregated water?" Boy, that one was hard. And I had to think, what does she mean? What does she mean? Oh, she meant, did I go and drink out of the colored fountain? And I had, yes, honey, I did drink segregated water. But just saying that little phrase made me think, oh Lord, I just come from the fountain, I am just from the fountain, Lord. I just come from the fountain, his name's so sweet. Oh my Lord, I just come from the fountain, I am just from the fountain, Lord. I just come from the fountain, his name's so sweet. And that came from that kid asking me, did I ever drink segregated water? Sometimes I make these really strange connections, so I hope that you will just follow me in good faith along the way. I'm going to turn to this text. It says, good morning and thank you all for coming. And I thank those who saw fit to invite me to try and give this day, invite me to speak on this day of remembrance. I would say nothing gives you more fear and trembling than to speak before an audience. And so I begin, after I saw all these people coming in the door with real fear and trembling. And I would like to begin with a reflection upon my childhood from Birmingham, Alabama. After I had come north, there were times when I would hear people refer to Birmingham as Birmingham, Alabama, because of its many tragedies. And when I remember, as it were, most of that is that we were among, my family was among those people who are anonymously situated in the Great Migration. We just came because some member of the family said to another member of the family, you can make $5 a day instead of $5 a week. And so my father heard that from his sister and took off for Ohio. My mother then followed almost immediately afterwards, and they left me to finish the semester in Birmingham. And no one has ever asked, but yes, I did go to a segregated school. And the teachers were pretty, I think, difficult, but they understood that education was important. And I can remember them saying, we have ours, you must get yours. And so I paid very strict attention to what it was they were trying to tell me from day one. When I remember that we came in that great movement called the Great Migration, Sonia Sanchez, who was also born in Birmingham, as was Margaret Walker, so that makes three of us who are writers coming from Birmingham. She said, we have come from the South, up South. And you have to think about that for a while, because what she really was saying was that we had traded blatant segregation for subtle segregation. And years later, I remember one of the things that struck me as, I'm going to drive right over you. There's a guy that sits on my left shoulder, and he says all sorts of things in my ear. I try to ignore him most times. But he said, you're going to drive over those people, and I just said it right out. So I'm hoping that he will mind his manners. As my mother would say, you have to be polite in public. I will read a poem that sort of picks up on that a little bit later. But at any rate, when I left the South, I remember only two statements, and one was the the conductor who came in the L&N train, which went north to south. Wasn't the Underground Railroad. I got on a real train. And the conductor said, we have just crossed the Mason and Dixie line. And I was 12 years old or 12 and a half, and I said, and that's that. And I don't know why I said that, but he just, I suddenly remembered that 20 years later, that I had responded to his announcement. And almost immediately when I was in Toledo, Ohio, my father took me downtown. So I got on the bus, as I was traditionally trained to do. I got on the bus and I went right to the back of the bus. And I sat down, and my father paid for the fare, and he came back and sat next to me. And then he leaned over very close and said, you don't have to sit in the back of the bus anymore. He didn't explain. I thought, that's strange. And I didn't ask, because in those days, you just didn't ask adults. What are you talking about? Why are you saying that? You know, my granddaughters and grandsons, why are you going this way? Because I want to. Why are you driving that way? Because I want to. And so it goes on and on, but it's one of those things where he just said something to me, and I thought, that's strange, he's telling me this. And one day after I'd started high school, I thought I would test it out and see what he really was saying was true. And so I got on the bus, knowing that if the conductor on the bus or the bus driver said, you must go to the back of the bus, I would do one of two things. If I was so embarrassed that I could hardly move, I would just get off the bus and walk home. But I got on the bus, paid my fare, and I sat immediately behind the bus driver, so that if he said anything, I would hear it and know what to do very quickly. I didn't want to get anybody else in trouble, and so that was my plan. He didn't say a word. He drove off. We drove on into town, got into town, and I got off the bus and sort of sighed. And I thought, my father was right. But, you know, it was one of those things where I had to test that piece of information that he had given me in confidence. And it was true. And we never talked about it. I never told him that I tested what you said today. And I rode the bus and nobody said anything. Nobody was upset. And so I went on home. So. I'm told that I'm supposed to start this speech with some jokes, or they tell you that you should start a speech with a joke. And the best I could come up with is by the late Julian Bond, who made himself into an astute and brilliant politician. He wrote the following couplet when he was a young man. Look at that gal, shake that thing. We can't all be Martin Luther King. Take your time. That's what comedians do, and I often wondered why they would do that. I'll wait. No, I'm just waiting. But to more serious fare, it was Naomi Long Madgett who remarked that I might have had a more substantial career had I not devoted so much time to Paul Laurence Dunbar. But it has also been suggested by the fugitive poet who was white, Alan Tate, that I add an old guy to my repertoire. And so as soon as I heard Margaret Walker in 1972 read Dunbar, I knew instantly that was to be my old guy. The rest is history, not a moment of regret for having spent that time either editing or researching or reading his poetry. Someone asked me last night at dinner, did I travel a lot? And I said, yes, I do. I've gone as far east as Alexandria, Egypt. I read at the library there, Dunbar, and as far west as Hawaii and the university there. And so I keep trying to spread him around as much as I can, because there are people who still do not know who he was, what he did, or how short a life he lived. He was, as far as I can tell, amazing. He wrote four novels. If you consider, he graduates at 18 or 19, and he lives to 33. That's a decade and a half. And he wrote 12 books of poetry, four novels, four books of short stories, two plays, and one opera with the British African composer Samuel Coleridge Taylor. I have to be careful with that name, because the other guy living in London at the same time as Coleridge Taylor was Samuel Taylor Coleridge, who was friends with Wordsworth. And so one is, I'm always careful not to make that mistake. But I may stop somewhere in the middle, the nice guy saying, some kid might want to ask me a question. So I will get busy. So I begin this morning with a reading from one of my mentors, Robert Hayden, who has written the memorable Frederick Douglass, which speaks in a myriad of voices that we remember this hour. Frederick Douglass. When it is finally ours, this freedom, this liberty, this beautiful and terrible thing, needful to man as air, usable as earth, when it belongs at last to all, when it is truly instinct, brain matter, diastole, systole, reflex action, when it is finally won, when it is more than the gaudy mumbo jumbo of politicians, this man, this Douglass, this former slave, this Negro, beaten to his knees, exile, visioning a world where none is lonely, none hunted, alien. This man, superb in love and logic, this man shall be remembered, oh, not with statues' rhetoric, not with legends and poems and wreaths of bronze alone, but with the lives grown out of his life, the lives fleshing this dream of the beautiful, needful thing. And here is Dunbar writing prophetically, I think, some 25 years before the birth of the Reverend Martin Luther King, in He Had His Dream. He had his dream, and all through life, worked up to it through toil and strife. afloat forever. Before his eyes, it colored for him all his skies. The storm cloud dark above his bark, the calm and listless vault of blue, took on his hopeful hue. He tinctured every passing beam. He had his dream. He labored hard and failed at last, his sails too weak to bear the blast. The raging tempest tore away and sent his beating bark astray. But what cared he for wind or sea? He said, "The tempest will be short. My bark will come to port." He saw through every cloud a gleam. He had his dream. Oh, by and by, I'm going to lay down this heavy load. Oh, by and by. I'm going to lay down this heavy load. And Langston Hughes, that mighty 20th century voice, reminding everyone how much African and African Americans has contributed to the cultures of the world with his insightful, "The Negro Speaks of Rivers," which sounds very much like a spiritual. And if you, the young kids, program or go on the internet and plug in Margaret Bonds, you will write that you will find that she has set this particular poem, and there are many, many African American singers singing it this day. So. The Negro Speaks of Rivers. I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my hut near the Congo and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. And I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans, and I've seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in the sunset. I've known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. But as we remember the horrors of our past, we are still want to praise those who have marched before us. Here is the sensitive Margaret Walker, who taught me her affection for the wonders in Dunbar. Here she is musing about Martin Luther King Jr., whom we celebrate today, in a poem titled Amos, Postscript, 1968. From Montgomery to Memphis he marches. He stands on the threshold of tomorrow. He breaks the bonds and bars of iron, and they remove the signs. He opens the gates of our prisons. He speaks to the captive hearts of America. He bears and hears the reward and their raw conscience. Here is a man of peace for the people. Amos is a prophet of the Lord. Amos speaks through eternity the glorious word of the Lord. One of the things I thought as when I received this invitation is that I thought I could revise all of African American literary history, and write it in favor of myself, rather than all of my contemporaries, and I could hear my mother saying, "Now be nice, just you be nice, because that's not the way I taught you to act in public." And so I thought, okay, I'll pay attention to her. Because in those days, your mother spoke, you sort of listened. Because I can remember at church, I would do something, and she'd say, "Don't do that." And I would do it again. And she'd say, "Please don't do that." And, you know, like a little kid, I would do it again. And she said, "I will see you when I get home." And it didn't matter how slow I walked. And she said, "The Lord put branches, little twigs out there that I can go and snap off. And so I'm going out to get me a switch." And she used it. That's all I can tell you. Here's a poem, and it's called "Street Demonstration," and it's by Margaret Walker. "We are hoping to be arrested and hoping to go to jail. We'll sing and shout and pray for freedom and for justice and for human dignity. The fighting may be long and some of us will die, but liberty is costly. And Rome, they tell me, was not built in a day. So hurry up, Lucille, hurry up. We are going to miss our chance to go to jail." And I think that's probably the only funny one. Here is "Alabama Centennial" by Naomi Long Maged, who writes of the frustration and the frustrating attitudes African Americans were faced with during the period of segregation. They said, "Well, wait." And I waited. For 100 years I waited. In cotton fields, kitchens, balconies, in bread lines, at back doors, on chain gangs, in stanking and stinking colored toilets, and crowded ghettos, outside of schools and voting booths. And some said, "Later." And some said, "Never." And then a new wind blew, and a new voice rode its wings with a quiet urgency, strong, determined, sure. "No," it said, "not never, not later, not even soon. Now, walk." And other voices echoed the freedom word. "Walk together, children, don't you get weary. Walk together, children, don't you get tired." Whispered them, sang them, prayed them, shouted them, "Walk!" And I walked in the streets of Montgomery until a link in the chain of patient acquiescence broke. And then again, "Sit down." And I sat down at the counters of Greensboro. "Ride." And I rode the bus for freedom. "Kneel." And I went down on my knees in prayer and faith. "March." And I'll march until the last chain falls, singing, "We shall overcome." Not all the dogs and hoses in Birmingham, not all the clubs and guns in Salem, not all the guns in Selma can turn this tide, not all the jails can hold these young black faces from their destiny of manhood, of equality, of dignity, of the American dream, 100 years past due. Now. It took me a long while to understand that every once in a while there is a kind of, let me just be blatant, reverse segregation. And this happened on one of my trips in the South. Somebody had gone and Googled my name and decided to invite me. And I went and I read. Sometimes black people are still uncomfortable with dialect. I have to be honest with you about that. And they don't like it to be spoken. They don't like anyone to make reference to it. And they don't much like Dunbar. Because on the one hand, I'm not going to say that. He made them laugh. And that's true. At any rate, but in my heart of hearts, I think that somehow or other, this white lady who had invited me because she thought that the kids needed to hear the variety of languages that we use, I think that the people who were black and in power dismissed her from her job. They wouldn't tell me that, but you know how you know things when nobody tells you? Like my mother could look at me and I'd know what she was thinking, and I couldn't read her mind, but I knew when she was going to do something very generous and kind, and I knew when she was upset or when I had hurt her. So I knew that those black people did that lady in, and she lost her job. So I wrote this poem. Took me a while to figure out how to write this poem, but I thought about the little kids going to school in Little Rock. And so I wrote this poem, and it's about, it's the school that's talking. So imagine as they are walking up the steps, the school and the steps feel the weight of the children as the community gathers to protest. The school feels that frustration and that anger. And so I wrote this poem. It's called The Steps of the Little Rock High School Speak Out on the First Day of Integration for Mary Dorsey. For I tell you, in all reality, the children did not actually know how many National Guardsmen it took to hold the door open and admit one Negro child to enter into my environment in a relaxed manner and without the fear or regard and anger he or she might have witnessed on the outside of my body. I remember them as timid, in fear, with some trepidation. Neither one of them sought the trials of this day by tears or fire, with which each flame being fed by the gasoline of hate. Nothing I can tell you burns as quickly. They would remember this morning, and I recollected myself from time to time and shudder at the remembrance because I never, ever dreamed that the human condition would come to this, nor represent itself in such a manner as to condemn itself for all eternity, plus some. Still, there was one kid who weighed so much, I doubt he hated anything. He was too busy feeding his face and body. I didn't think about anyone that could be that hungry, but I think he was, and I could hear the other children taunting him with the word fatty, and never realize what they meant until he put one foot on the first step of my facade. I don't know how the scales ever told him anything. They were probably begging for a sigh of relief or had fallen unconscious They wanted him off and quickly. Let me tell you, I never hurt like a groan that he put on me ever. He had the kind of weight on his bones that no one ever expects to measure. It is a sure shame that his parents let him eat until he couldn't get up from the table. I remember him coming directly in after the little black children with nothing on his mind but eating and learning. He was in a terrible hurry, and to get as much of both as he could and to get the hell away from Arkansas. The little black kids were still dressed to kill. I stopped to tell you what dressed to kill means. In the black neighborhood, if you were dressed to kill, you had on your Sunday best, because if you died, they took you right on to the funeral home and laid you out. And that's why black people say when they see somebody, lady or man, he is dressed to kill. So you can just go on away, right? Okay. So this little black kid were dressed to kill, hair brushed and combed, faces and teeth clean, their clothes washed and starched and ironed to a fairly well. I know I could not have done any better, and certainly did not have any money enough to pay for anyone to do better. Well, I do remember about that day, and what I remember is that all the respectable white mothers and fathers were standing in front of my doors, shouting the most vitriolic statements that they would set my blood boiling and ready to scald any and everything it touched. Go home! Go home! We don't want you here. And the blacks, who were bystanders, knew that what they spoke was as true as their soul allowed them to speak publicly. Although years later, I fancy they might see reason to be mightily ashamed of how they appeared that day or the subsequent days they paraded in front of me. But for the moment, all I can say is that these nine, ushered in by the hand of the law, were prepared to learn as much as possible. They would remember President Eisenhower, who had given them this political privilege for as long as they lived and for as long as time lasted, whichever one came first. And the community was beset with mourning, leaders and citizens, as each one took up the cause for freedom. From Medgar Evers by David Ignatow. They're afraid of me because I remind them of the ground. The harder they step on me, the closer I am pressed to the earth. And hard, hard they step, growing more frightened and vicious. Will I live? They will lie in the earth, buried in me. And above them, a tree will grow for shade. Ignatow was one of my mentors and one of my teachers. James Emanuel wrote in my time, and I met him, but he, like many African Americans who fought in the First War, and some who fought even in the Second War, decided to take refuge in Paris, France. And James Emanuel was one of those. No, he would come every once in a while, like Josephine Baker, I think to make money, and then go back to Paris with what he collected. This is called Emmett Till. I hear a whistling through the waters. Little Emmett Till won't be still. He keeps floating round the darkness, edging through the silent chill. Tell me, please, that bedtime story of the fairy river boy who swims forever deep in the treasures necklaced in a coral toy. American History by Michael Harper. Those four black girls blown up in that Alabama church remind me of 500 Middle Passage blacks in a net underwater in Charleston Harbor, so redcoats won't find them. Can't find what you can't see, can you? And Margaret Walker again for Andy Goodman, Michael Schwerner, and James Cheney, three civil rights workers. Why should another die for me? Why should there be a Calvary, a subterranean hill for three? In the miry clay, in the muddy stream, in the red misery, in the mutilating hatred and in fear, the brutish and the brazen, without brain, without blessing, without beauty. They have killed these three. They have killed them for me. And when we thought justice loomed on the horizon with all of its hopeful possibilities, it was X.J. Kennedy who pointed out that JFK was assassinated down in Dallas. Down in Dallas, down in Dallas, where the shadow of blood lies black, Lee Oswald nailed Jack Kennedy up with the nail of a rifle crack. The big bright Cadillac stomped on their brakes and the man in the street fell still when the slithering gun, like a tooth of sin, coiled back from the windowsill. In the white room and chrome room, on the tabletop, oh, they tried all a scalpel knows, but they couldn't spell stop to that drop by drop till it loomed into a rigid rose. Down on the altar, down on the altar, Christ blossoms in bread and wine, but each asphalt stone where the blood dropped down is burst to a cactus spine. Oh, down in Dallas, where a desert wind walks by night, Lee Oswald nailed Jack Kennedy up on the cross of a rifle sight. He bowed his head and died, and he never said a mumbling word. He bowed his head and died, and he never said a mumbling word, not a word, not a word, not a word. Ah, This guy said, why don't I ask if somebody has a question? That'll break up the mood.
What?
Hush, hush, child, we in public. Nobody? Yes.
You were raised in Toledo, obviously. You yes. mentioned the Toledo yes. system. What brought you to Dayton?
Kit Marie brought me to Dayton, and she was a colleague. We were in graduate school together, and her husband knew George Starbuck, who was a very fine poet, and she knew me, and so I guess the powers that were asked them, who should we invite for our writer's workshop, and she nominated me, and Lou nominated George Starbuck. And so we both descended on Dayton, and we stayed here for 3 days, in which time I think, you may remember, B.J. Bedard offered me a job. And I had been at that point to Chicago, somewhere outside of Chicago, and I'd come to Cincinnati for an interview, and then I didn't realize we were that close to Cincinnati. and so when I was plotting this tour, I had to go back to the airport, which is miles away in Kentucky, and then fly to Dayton, which took 2 minutes. So I talked to the lady who plotted all this out for me and said, next time we've got to do better, because I could have hopped in a car and driven to Dayton by the time we went through all that. At any rate, so they offered me a job, and I went back to Grand Rapids, where I was teaching at Aquinas College, and my best friend, who was Caucasian, picked me up, and I sort of fell into his Porsche. He was well-to-do. Not only handsome, but he had lots of money. At any rate, I fell in his car. He drove me home and said, I don't think I've ever seen you this exhausted. And I said, I don't think I've ever been this tired. He said, well, why don't you go home and sleep, and I'll pick you up, and we'll go to dinner later. And that's what we did. And then I had all these jobs to figure out. And I just closed my eyes and pointed. And it was Dayton. And so I immediately walked into Miriam Hall and knew that that was supposed to be the last place that I was supposed to come. And the only reason I knew that was because there was a man who taught speech. But all the speeches were on cameras and televisions. And the kids were not paying attention to that. And they were leaving the leaving the auditorium like mad, and the TAs couldn't stop them. I heard one say, you already have left 3 times. He said, I don't care, I'm going. So he left, and so I put in my mind that I shouldn't come to this school, but I came. And then, strangely enough, one day walked into my office, put my African literature textbook on the desk, and it opened. And lo and behold, I looked down at it. And this was 1970, and it said, Paul Laurence Dunbar, 1872-1906. 1872, this is 1970. In 2 years, he will be 100 years old had he lived. And I thought at that moment I had to invite all of my living poet friends, like Nikki Giovanni, Sonia Sanchez, Michael Harper, Raymond Patterson, who caused me to pick all these people's poems. He's been in my mind for a while, and I can't begin to tell you why. But at any rate, that's how I came to Dayton. You didn't want to know that.
Does Toledo
Oh, okay. I grew up in Toledo, and when I was, I went to undergraduate school there, and I had been there so long that I began to believe, as I heard some people say, Toledo is the worst place for Hanukkah, Christmas, and New Year's. And so I thought I was never going to escape Toledo. I thought it really had its claws on me. But years later, they offered me a job for tons of money. I mean, really, in the 60s, $20,000 or $30,000 was a lot of money for a beginning person like me. And I said no, because I didn't ever think that I would become independent enough to walk out of my mother's house and not need her. And that was a fear, because she said, you will need me. And I thought I did, except one Christmas when I was working, and it was like this, and I was delivering mail, and I was still as skinny as I am now, and it was cold, and my toes froze, my hands froze, and I could hardly move. So, you know, something says, what to do? Call mama. I dialed the phone. One ringy-dingy, two ringy-dingies, at any rate. And she answered the phone, and I said, mama, it is cold out here. I cannot move my toes, and my hands are frozen. A little silence, and then she said, what do you want me to do about it? Oh, I was beginning to feel warm. And she said, long sermon that many of you know, I go to work, sick or well, rain or shine, snow or storm, blah de blah, blah de blah. She went on and on and on. And I didn't say anything, I just listened. And finally she said, what can I do for you? And I said, nothing. And I was warm. And I hung up the phone, like little kids who are far away from their parents do. Kabam, 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 kabam. And I, in those days, it was, the phone booth was on the corner. And I opened up the phone booth, and the cold wind said, look out, here he come. And I walked out, and I did two tours of walking with the 50 pounds of mail, because I went and delivered that, and I went back and delivered some more, and I came back a third time, and they said, would you like to go on a truck and deliver packages? And I said, I don't care. And I was just that warm that my mother fired me up enough that I would not be dependent on her. And living in her house and having her take care of me all these years. So in some ways, you know, what that phone call got me out and made me know what it was I had to do. And I went and did it, and I never ever turned back. And that's why I didn't take that $30,000 that Toledo offered me. Because my mother said, well, you can live in my house and save your money. And I had already gone to New York, and I thought, I don't think that I better do that. You know, something else tells you. And I loved my mother. I really did love her, because she knew, she told me lots of things that I've been muttering to myself these many years that she's been gone. Then that was right. Well, I had to do it this way. She says, I know, you're hard-headed. But they said, hard head makes a
soft behind.
Soft behind. So we had a lot of mothers saying the same things.
Yes,
yes we did. Yes, we did. So let me, I don't want to go on too much longer. Let me read you snippets of three pieces and one of my own. This is by Ishmael Reed, who many years ago said something that caused me not to go to that Washington rally. And I'll tell you what it was. He said, I'm going to get on that mall and I'm going to read poems and everybody's going to be together. And I thought, that's not why we were supposed to go to Washington. And I just could not bring myself to go to Washington because I thought we were going to do something untoward and not justifiable. And so I thought I shouldn't have paid any attention at all, but at any rate. This is called Black Power Poem. A specter is haunting America, the specter of hoodooism. All the powers of old America have entered into a holy alliance to exorcise this specter. Allen Ginsberg, Timothy Leary, Richard Nixon, Richard Daley, Time Magazine, the New York Review of Books, and the Underground Press may the best church win. Shake hands and come out conjuring. We need a clear language, able storytellers, discoverers of crops and seeds. We need decipherers and investigators of ideas and promise. For parents screaming music that will arm us with the wisdom of the first warnings of surrogate mothers and the gene pool fathers. We need memory and moments. Melody and song, expanding visions in search of winning ways and noble tomorrows. I walk back now with this poem through the holes the old folks left in their eyes for me to enter through, walk back to where I see them there, the ones that have gone beyond hardness, the ones that have gone beyond form, see them there, darker than where roots began and lighter than where they go with their spirits. Heavier than stone, their memories sometimes brighter than the flash of sudden lightning. But green branches will grow from these roots, darker than time and blacker than even the ashes of nations. Sweet flowers will sprout and wave their love-stroke language in sun-tongued morning's shadow. In the spirit, in all of our lives. That poem was by Quincy Troop. Here is the great Lucille Clifton writing about Malcolm. Nobody mentioned war, but closed doors. But doors were closed. Black women shaved their heads. Black men rustled in the alleys like leaves. Prophets were ambushed as they spoke, and from their holes, black eagles flew, screaming through the streets. And maybe I should. Here is Raymond Patterson. I think is underrated, but really was one of the great 20th century people writing. At that moment, when they shot Malcolm Little down on the stage of the Audubon Ballroom, where his life ran out through bullet holes, like the people running out when the murder began, His blood soaked the floor. One drop found a crack through the stark pounding thunder, slipped under the stage and began its journey, burrowed through the concrete into the cellar, dropped down blackness, exploding like quicksilver, pellets of light. Panicking rats, paralyzing cockroaches, tunnel through rubble and wrecks of foundations, the rocks that buttress the bowels of the city, flowed into pipes and power lines, the main and cables of the city. 1,000 fiery seeds at that moment. Those who drank water where he entered, those who cooked food where he passed, those who burned lights while he listened, those who were talking as he went, knew he was water running out of the faucets, gas running out of the jets, power running out of the sockets, meaning running along taut wires to the hungers of their living. It is said, while slums clotted Harlem, plumbing groaned and sundered free that day, and discontinued and disconnected gas and light, and went on and on and on, and they rushed his brittle body on a stretcher to the hospital, but the police were too late. It had already happened. And finally, two little pieces. It has an epigraph. This is behavior. And the epigraph runs like this, and I'll tell you, because I have to be honest, it's my mother who said this. I was the trustworthy kid in the family, and they could send me to pay the bills and come home with the receipt. And I was always to come home with the receipt because that meant that they had paid their bills. Be on your best behavior, for God only knows what I will find when I get the news that you are in jail and I have to get a lawyer and come to that jailhouse to bail you out. They could not have named you for the second inaugural poet. It would have been incestuous. You are black like the president, and perhaps even a tad more black because, as far as you can tell, your parents are more black than he is. And it is clear that he is biracial. And that clears up one fact. Secondly, you have a halo of blue around your eyes. And that means somewhere, someone white lurks in your heritage. And third, it is now open season on black men and boys. So if you trip, you're dead. Who's to prosecute? Now you answer me that. You have to take care of yourself. And that is a given these days. No one is safe, which means we got to pray and pray hard that you are safe and that this president makes it out of that White House and makes it back to Chicago or wherever the hell he wants to go to retire. And that's the least we can do for him, get him home safely, and maybe we can take some time off and relax, because as far as I can see or tell, we are just exiting the Civil War and moving rapidly towards segregation, and we are going to need a few white people to stand up and say that that is what is happening and that that is wrong, and we need to change our civil laws, and Lord knows what is going to happen to us when we stupidly elect a woman for president.
Should I help you get out of that one?
No. Because I may be one of those. I'm going to wrap up with this one. That's my mother talking in that poem. And she would say to me, I know that's supposed to be me. And I thought, okay. So I didn't say any more about it. Here is the great Gwendolyn Brooks, which I would like to close with. Martin Luther King. A man went forth with gifts. He was a prose poem. He was a tragic grace. He was a warm music. He tried to heal the vivid volcanoes. His ashes are reading the world. His dream still wishes to anoint the barricades of faith and control. His word still burns the center of the sun above the thousand and thousand and the hundred thousand. And the word was justice. It was spoken. So it shall be spoken. So it shall be done. My God is so high, you can't get over him, he's so low. You can't crawl under, he is so wide. You can't get around, you have to come in by and through the Lamb. One day as I was walking along the heavenly road, my Savior spoke unto me, and he filled my heart with love. Because he was so high, you can't get over him, he's so low. You can't crawl under, he is so wide. You can't get around, you have to come in by and through the Lamb. Thank you very much.
Dr. Herbert Martin, thank you so much. And just as a reminder, Dr. Martin's books are just beyond those doors. And I wanted to say also that Birmingham is a place for great thinkers, not only Margaret Walker and yourself and Sonia Sanchez, but regardless of your politics, Condoleezza Rice and Angela Davis. So great thinkers, that's for sure. On the back of your programs, there is the community pledge that is read each and every year, and we invite you to partake in that. And Michelle Wusty from Incarnation School is going to lead us in that.
I have not always valued people who are different. I pledge to honor the dignity and inherent worth of every human being. I have not always practiced compassion for people. I pledge to oppose justice, not evil. I have sometimes been more concerned about my rights than the rights of others. I pledge to dedicate myself to use my talents to empower others as I empower myself. I have not always stood up against injustice or denounced violence.
I pledge to consciously practice peace on a daily basis.
I have sometimes been reluctant to embrace differences and appreciate the value of every human being.
I pledge to treat each person that I meet with courtesy, respect, and fairness.
Thank you, Michelle. Michelle Westy, Incarnation School. And that is authored by Dr. Sarah Harris. Dr. Harris is a former Montgomery County Commissioner who retired to Las Vegas and is enjoying golf somewhere at about right now, in 70 degrees, I think. 2017 promises to be another great year for this breakfast, and Mr. John Gretz is going to give us a preview.
It's fitting that Dr. Martin talked about Birmingham, because next year our speaker is going to be a woman by the name of Barbara Cross. She was 14 in 1963 and was her father was the pastor of the 16th Street Baptist Church. Her classmates, three of whom were three of the four girls who were killed that day. She was in Sunday school that day. They had the theme of the day was a love that forgives, if you can believe that. She was with those girls, but her teacher asked her to stay back and help her to fill out some forms on Sunday school attendance. Otherwise, she would have been in that bathroom with her friends. She survived that and has gone on to be a powerful speaker and advocate of all things about inclusion and why she was there, why she was spared. Wonderful lady and powerful, powerful story. So you come next year. Good times. She's good. And we want to mention, honestly, for that, if you are interested in coming next year, you can, a great way to do that, especially, is if you're planning on sponsoring a table, you can go ahead and get your table now. If you'd like to just to say that you would like to come next year, you can go ahead and just put your own name, and am I right to say that they can? Okay, yes, if you'd like to, especially if you'd like to contribute to bring her in, because we do have expenses to bring that in, so we'd love to have your participation and help with that. So we do hope to see you next year.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being here this morning, and Dr. Martin, excellent. Thank you so much. Such information that you've given us. We appreciate it. We are going to ask Pastor Dwight Ford from the Centerville Community Church to send us home safely.
Unfortunately, Reverend Ford has had a sore throat, and they've asked me to do the benediction this morning as well. If you'd please rise for the benediction. Friends, let us go from this place inspired and encouraged. But dreams of justice and extravagant love dance in our heads. Let us live the pledge that we have spoken, so that whenever the dark clouds of prejudice and injustice are found, and whenever the deep fog of misunderstanding and fear drenches our community, that we will be the ones who know how to rise up shining like the sun, armed not with violence, anger, or hate, but armed only with the will to work for justice, to act lovingly toward our neighbor, to seek reconciliation, and to practice the golden rule. Martin Luther King Jr. has shown us a better way, and we honor him best by showing that way through our own lives, at this particular time, in this place that we call home and community. So let us go now in peace and with the courage to love. Amen.
Mike Castle. The Reverend Dr. Mike Castle, his alter ego is that of Dwight Ford. So. Thank you.